So if you believe that the situation that you are going through is so hard, is so difficult, is unimaginable, that things cannot turn around, I am here to tell you this morning that that is a lie. Because God can turn things around for you. There's a restoration here this morning. There's a restoration.
This is GBC Web TV, on the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can watch inspiring biblical teaching and other excellent Christian videos. You can order the teaching video DVDs, listen to and study the audio versions of these, or download them as audio podcasts to your computer or MP3 player. Today's inspiring and biblical teaching is called Our Weakness Becomes God's Opportunity, 2 Corinthians 4, verse 8 and 9, by Rotimi Awoniyi.
We are hard-pressed on every side, but not crushed, perplexed, but not in despair, persecuted, but not abandoned, struck down, but not destroyed. We are hard-pressed on every side. That God created in His own very image, but we moved away from Him. It is therefore not very hard for us to be pressed on every side, to be perplexed, and to be persecuted. And as you woke up this morning, what was it that dominated your life? Was it that you felt that everything would just go away? Was it that you were overwhelmed? Many of us have situations in our lives that make us want to give up. I believe I'm speaking about most of us here this morning. But God is here present with us this morning. And He's going to meet with us, and He's going to speak to us, and He's going to intervene on our behalf. Before we continue, I'd like us to pray. Father God, we thank You for this morning. We thank You for the opportunity that we have. We thank You for the grace that we have in the death of Jesus Christ, so that we can claim salvation, so that we can come before the throne with everything in our lives and leave them there. And Heavenly Father, we pray that as You minister to us this morning, we pray that Your grace will be at work. Your anointing will be at work among us and in our midst in Jesus' name. Heavenly Father, many of us have come before the throne this morning with many things in our lives, with various things in our lives. But I believe that You will meet with us and You will intervene on our behalf in Jesus' name. So as you woke up this morning, you think of the situations that you are going through, and you thought, do I really want to go to church this morning? I just feel like staying in bed. Because that situation is so overwhelms me that I don't feel like facing anyone. But the psalmist says, even though I walk through the shadow through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for You are with me. I will fear no evil. Why then do we allow things to overwhelm us? Why then do we take life as if it is the beginning and the end of everything? If we call ourselves the children of the kingdom, why then do we allow things to batter us down? When I can say my Redeemer lives, why don't I turn to Him? When you can say your Redeemer lives, why not turn to Him? I want you to remember this morning, there's a covenant signed, sealed, and delivered on your life. And that covenant is alive today. It's alive always. It's alive for you to claim, to draw on. It's alive for you to just hold on to. That covenant was signed, sealed, and delivered on your behalf many thousands of years ago. And our God, your God, my God, is a God that does not lie. When he says, I'm going to be there for you, he means he's going to be there for you. When he tells you, do not be afraid, he means do not be afraid. I want you to remember there's a covenant signed pertaining to you. So this morning we'll be talking about our weaknesses becomes God's opportunity. Our weaknesses become God's opportunity. God's opportunity to intervene in the things happening in our lives, in the things happening surrounding us. God's opportunity to move things beyond the level that we can even begin to comprehend. In 1 Samuel, there was a friendship that was formed by David and Jonathan. And that friendship led to both of them signing a covenant. They didn't sit down and sign it, but there was a covenant between them. They swore oath. David and Jonathan entered into covenant concerning what was happening to David. Remember, David was being sought out to be killed by Jonathan's father, Saul. Many years after becoming king, David asked, "Is there anyone still left of the house of Saul to whom I can show kindness for Jonathan's sake?" And this morning, for Jesus' sake, God is going to touch people here this morning. When you enter into covenant, when you sign a contract, it is binding on the parties that sign. And as human beings, we've seen, you read the newspaper, you hear on news. If you go to the high court, you hear of people that have signed contracts and breached those contracts. When you sign contract with someone, you expect one party to execute and the other party to receive some kind of benefit. But as human beings, we tend sometimes to think that as we go along, to think that this contract is becoming too much. I cannot make profit out of this contract. Therefore, I want to find the best way out. But when you sign contract with God, it is permanent. It is permanent. God does not think that, oh, because Timmy has been very naughty this way, I'm going to find a way to invalidate that contract. God does not think like that. And this Jonathan and David story is interesting because of the way that things moved on. You remember Jonathan was killed along with his father, and eventually David became king. If you are like me and everyone, possibly any human being, you enjoy being the king and doing the things that the king does. Someone brings your clothes in the morning. Anyone seen them coming to America before? The king wakes up in the morning and someone brushes his teeth. someone puts his clothes on him. He walks and someone throws petals along the way for him. And you think, yeah, this is life. Anyone else, just forget. That's me. But David remembered. We are told that the king was told, there's still a son of Jonathan. He is crippled in both feet. Remember these things. Jonathan's son was not born crippled. He wasn't born crippled. He fell at the age of 5 when his nurse was hurriedly taking him away when they heard the news of Jonathan's death. He was living in an outstation from center of action at the time the king was asking about him. So he had become a neglected, a forgotten entity. Because the fact that the Saul's household was no longer in control, he had become a forgotten entity. And this morning you may feel that no one seems to be bothering about me. No one seems to be concerned about what is happening in my life. No one seems to be asking, what's wrong with you? Why is this problem there? No one seems to be doing that. I tell you, God is very much interested in what is happening in your life. God is very much interested in what is happening to you today, every day of your life. Things happen in our lives to bring us to the position we are. It may be because of things that we have done or actions that we have taken. The simple fact is, when things happen in life to us, there's possibility that it is because something we have done or actions that we have taken. And it could be because of things that is outside of our control. I believe for us, sitting down here, when you hear about the credit crunch, you think this is something that is not started in UK. It started about 4,000 or 5,000 miles away by some people just sitting down and doing things and selling credit and all sort of things. But today we are all affected. We are all affected. But I want you to bear some things in mind. The fact that the credit crunch is here is because of the things that some people have done, some actions that some people have done. It's possible, if you are a banker, I'm sorry, it's possible that you have contributed to it in some way. I don't think we have a banker here, do we? I apologize if we do. I'm not trying to cast aspersions. It may be because of events outside of your control. You may be living in that distant place, out in the desert, desolate place. But this morning, it's time to come back home. It's time to come back home. It's time to start to take possession of your inheritance. It's time to come back and be soaked by God's Spirit and God's anointing. So David asked, is there anyone in the house of Saul that I can be of benefit to? And he was told that, yes, Jonathan had a son. He was crippled. His name was Mephibosheth. And when he came, he knelt before the king and refer to himself as a dirty dog. For someone to call himself a dead dog, it means he thought he's finished. I have nothing else to live for. I am right at the end of my life. But David said, "Do not fear. I'm here to tell you that your King, my King, the Lord of Lords, the Maker of all things, is here this morning to meet with you specially. Because there's a covenant signed, sealed, and delivered concerning you." Again, I want to repeat the psalmist saying, "Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil." And this morning, whatever you are going through, whatever your situations, whatever your circumstances, God is here present. And you just need to lock up with him. You need to engage with him. You need to let him take control of things. Remember, when you are serving God, you need to focus on him. You need him with you, always by your side, walking with you. I want to read this passage. David asked, "Is there anyone still left of the house of Saul to whom I can show kindness for Jonathan's sake?" Now there was a servant of Saul's household named Ziba. They called him to appear before David. And the king said to him, "Are you Ziba, your servant?" He replied. The king asked, "Is there no one still left of the house of Saul to whom I can show God's kindness?" Ziba answered the king, "There's still a son of Jonathan. He is crippled in both feet." "Where is he?" the king asked. Ziba had answered, "He is in the house of Michai, son of Amiel, in Lo Debar." So King David had him brought from Lo Debar, from the house of Michai, son of Amiel. When the son of Jonathan, the son of Saul, came to David, he bowed down to him in honor. David said, "Mephibosheth." "Your servant," he replied. "Do not be afraid," David said to him, "for I will surely show you kindness for the sake of your father, Jonathan." He was crippled. He was in an outpost, living in an outpost. He had nothing. He had to live on the generosity of people around. And this morning, it may be that you are crippled spiritually. You're living out of grace. It may be that you are asking questions about your life. It may be that things are not going the way that you want. This morning, there's a redeeming power at work. There's a redeeming authority ready to turn things around. There's a redeeming grace ready to meet you at your point of need. Our God is alive, and is alive forever and ever. When the children of Israel, they left Egypt, they got to the edge of the Red Sea, the sea in front, Pharaoh's army at the back. Some of them thought, "Yeah, that is finished. We have been brought out of, although we were slaves, but we have been brought out of slavery to die out here in this desert." But God is alive. He is alive. He is alive.
Amen.
He made the children of Israel go through the parted sea. They walked through, and the soldiers, the army, Pharaoh's army, perished in that sea. The God that we worship is not some dummy God that you put in the corner of your house or your room. It's not some painted image that you just leave there and you go and bow before every morning before you go out of your house. It's not some far distance king or lord that you have to call on, you cut yourself, that you have to do things that you cannot imagine in life. He is here present. He is with you every day, at all times, for all purposes, for all situations, for all circumstances. He is alive. There is a breakthrough available for us. There's a move of God's power about to be manifested in our lives. David said, "Do not be afraid, for I will surely show you kindness for the sake of your father, Jonathan. I will restore you. I will restore to you all the land that belonged to your father, and you will always eat at my table." What a turnaround. What a turnaround. So if you believe that the situation that you are going through is so hard, is so difficult, is unimaginable, that things cannot turn around, I am here to tell you this morning that that is a lie. Because God can turn things around for you. There's a restoration here this morning. There's a restoration. God's power is real. God's power is real. As I was preparing for this, there was this song that came just in my head. And I thought, that's nice. The steadfast love of God never ceases. His mercy never comes to an end. They are new every morning, new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness, O Lord. Great is thy faithfulness. They are new every morning, new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness, O Lord. Great is thy faithfulness. They are renewed every morning. That covenant is renewed every morning. When you wake up, it's new, brand new. It's not some old document stashed away somewhere in a dark room, somewhere that you don't see. When someone asks you, as someone, Warren, when you've been working for, you worked for car rental, national car rental, for how many years? Can they find your contract of employment? Can they find your contract of employment?
The only one they could find was 1998.
If you work with an employer for so many years, and after 30 years, and you think, I'd like to see that contract of employment, I'm very sure someone somewhere from HR will come around and say, I'm not sure we can find that anymore. But it's not like that with God. That contract is life because it is renewed every morning for you. It is renewed. And because of you, Jesus Christ went to the cross to die. And when you call upon his name, he is there listening, waiting for you, and able to move on your behalf, able to change things on your behalf. God's power is life. He formed the mountains by his power. If he can do that, how much more your small problem? Yeah, your problem may be big, but I tell you, to God, it is small. You know this thing that this scientist in Geneva were talking about, this neutron. Very tiny, I don't think human eye can see it. That's probably how big your problem is. Where God is concerned, minuscule. About £3 billion or something like that was spent to set it up. Huge money. Huge amount of money. Someone was saying we could have used that to build more houses. For that minuscule thing. Your problem is huge, yes. But give glory to God, because that big problem is small in God's sight. I know, Job said, I know that you can do all things. No plan of yours can be thwarted. What more can I say? Nothing. Our God is in heaven. He does whatever pleases him. It is good. I can wake up in the morning and just think, is in control. And just get on with doing things I have to do. It is possible this morning that you are thinking, how is he going to do this for me? I want you to remember some things. God never lies. If he tells you, I'm going to do this, he's going to do it. I know that's the difference between God and man.
When students asked for things, you know, the student union, and you go to the vice chancellor or the principal or whatever, and you present your list like that, and he looks at it and nods his head, you know, how they do all those eggheads. And he says, all things being equal, that list will be all right. Everything will be sorted. Just give it 2 months, and the leaders will come out. Yes, he has promised us everything will be done. In 2 months, he said. And then after 2 months, nothing is done. You go back to him, and he said, I didn't tell you everything will be done. I said, all things being equal. There's a difference between definitely I will do it, and all things being equal, I will do it. The simple fact is, things can never be equal. All things being equal means if there's money, we'll do it. We don't have money, therefore we don't do it. That's human for you. With God, when he says, I will do it, he will do it. When he says, I will move mountain, I will open this sea for you to go through, he will do it. He said, the Bible says, where two or three are gathered, there I am. And we are more than two here this morning. We are a tad more than two. He's here with us. He's present with us. And he's able to move on our behalf. And remember, for him, nothing is impossible. Our impossibility becomes His possibility. So, I want to read from Romans chapter 4, verse 21. Actually, I think I'll start from 18, verse 18. Against all hope, Abraham in hope believed, and so became the father of many nations, just as it had been said to him, "So shall your offspring be." Without weakening in his faith, he faced the fact that his body was as good as dead, since it was about 100 years, and that Sarah's womb was also dead. Yet he did not waver through unbelief regarding the promise of God, but was strengthened in his faith and gave glory to God, being fully persuaded that God had power to do what he has promised. Abraham, 100 years. When you are 100 years this age, you think, you see many people thinking, "I'm just waiting for God to come." At that age, God said to Abraham, "You are going to have a son." I tell you, if someone tells me I'm going to have a son at the age of 100, I'll be happy. Don't worry, Ola. But he thought, in his human sense, everything is dead. His wife's womb is dead. He's just waiting for his grave to come. But God said, "You are going to have a son. Not that only, that, but you are going to be father of many nations." And you'll be thinking, many nations. I haven't even got one son or one child. Talk of many nations. But he held on in faith. He believed it. He claimed it. He lived it. That is what is wrong in our lives sometimes. When God promises us, we need to believe it, we need to hold it, we need to claim it, and we need to live it. You see, there's difference between just someone telling you things, prophesying over you, unless you claim it, unless you live it, unless you make it your own. It may never come to pass. When God speaks to us, when God tells us something, we need to start to act it. That is why I say that as children of the kingdom, when God says, "You are my children, and God in heaven is the king," I will walk like a child of the king. I will walk, I will claim the things that belong to me. Sometimes we kind of become too timid. We become afraid to claim that which belongs to us. As the children of God, when God says, "I will go with you, do not be afraid," what more do I need to hear? Nothing. Because God has told me, "Do not be afraid. I will go with you." Then why do we refuse at all times to claim that which belongs to us? Why do we let situations and circumstances overwhelm us? Why do we let the things of this world become our Lord? God is alive. He is alive. And when He promises, He fulfills. When He tells you something, He's not saying maybe. He's saying, "I will." There's a difference between only legal people use maybe as will. But for you and me, when someone tells me maybe, it means it's not possible. Well, may not be possible. But when God tells you, I will, he will do it. He will fulfill his purpose in your life. He will bring to bear that thing which he has promised to you. He fulfills his promises. Being fully persuaded that God had power to do what he had promised. Then, why do we let things dominate our lives? Why do you let things then become mission impossible for you? When you can say, my Redeemer is alive, my Lord is alive, why is it difficult to let him take control, to let him take charge? He is able to do more than we can comprehend. He's able to do more than he can comprehend. Some years back, my Timmy, it was a bank holiday, August bank holiday, I believe. We were sitting down, and as we sat down to watch a film, I went out to, that's when Variety Video was still in Greenford, to watch this film. I was sitting on the floor, he was sitting on the couch behind me. He had been complaining of tummy ache. Suddenly, he started throwing up. He was taken to hospital, and they said that he had some conditions and that he needed to be operated. This boy was in so much agony. And one day, he turned to his mom and said, Mom, am I going to die? So I went out to the corridor, to the passage, and I said, God, you gave me this child. You gave us this child. You knew what he went through when he was born. You were in charge then. And I have no reason to doubt that you are not present here. I have every reason to believe that you are present and you are going to intervene. Shortly after that, the surgeon came in after various tests. He said, I'm going to try and do the operation, but I'm not promising you anything. I said, fine, no problem. All I ask is that you try your best. I said, don't worry about that. And I was told that the operation would take place so time. We're looking about 5 to 6 hours. So you can go away and do whatever you want to do and come back in 5 to 6 hours time. So I went away thinking I'll come back just on the dot 5 hours, just in case. I came back, he was back. And they said, oh, he's been back for about 3 hours. Oh? Why is that? The surgeon came and said, well, when we opened him up, things had happened, and we didn't have to do as much as we expected to do. I believe that was God at work. I believe that was God at work. Yes, I'm grateful to the medical staff, for the doctors, for the nurses, for the surgeon, everybody. But God took control. So if you let this morning God to take control, He's able to. You may think that He has forgotten about you. You may think that your problem is so big, massive. You may think that the whole world is totally against you. You may think that it's life worth living again. I tell you, life is worth living. And God is in charge, He's in control. What we need to do is take those things to Him. This morning you may be thinking, what's this faith all about? It's about a God that is alive. It is personal to me. It is personal to you. He never lies. He says it as He sees it. And remember, before you were born, He knows everything about you. He knows the very minute, the very second you are conceived. He knows you because He made you. He molded you. And He's prepared and willing to deal with those situations for you. He's prepared and willing to deal with those problems for you. He's prepared and willing to meet you at your very point of need. He hasn't forgotten. David forgot his covenant with Jonathan for so long. At the time of Jonathan's death, that boy was 5 years old. When David remembered his covenant with Jonathan, that boy had already had his own son. It's a long time. If you read that passage again, that man already had his own son. That was a long time. But God is here present. Here, His covenant with you, about you, concerning you, is permanent and is life. There's nothing old about it. Every day, every morning, every minute, every moment, He is willing, He is able to do it. Our God lives and He saves. He fulfills His promise. In Isaiah, He says, "Yes, and from ancient days I am He. No one can deliver out of my hand. When I act, who can reverse it?" That's the message we need to take out with us this morning. When God acts, nobody can reverse it. Doors that He closes, nobody can open. And doors that He opens, nobody can close it. So concerning you, concerning your situations, God is at work and He's going to meet you at your very point of need. But we need to have faith. We need to hold on to Him. We need to declare Him as Lord and God. We need to come before the throne of grace and ask God to take control of everything in our lives. Not just that situation, but everything, including ourselves. Because the Bible says, you cannot serve God and you cannot serve two masters. You cannot serve two masters. There's restoration for you. He's ready to do it.
Let's pray.
Father in heaven, we thank you. We thank you for your words that you have spoken to us this morning. We thank you for your promises. We thank you for your covenant pertaining our lives. We thank you because you are Lord and you are God. We thank you because you are alive forever and ever. Heavenly Father, as we come before you, you know the needs of each and every one of us here this morning. You know our desires. You know our problems. You know the things that we are struggling with. You know the things that overwhelm us. Father, in Jesus' name, we pray that you just meet us at that very point in Jesus' name. We declare for among your children this morning, Father, we declare a restoration in Jesus' name. Heavenly Father, the things that have been stolen from them, Father, we declare in the name of Jesus Christ that you restore to them in Jesus' name. Heavenly Father, for those of us that have walked away from you, this is time of restoration, to be restored to the kingdom, to be children of the kingdom, to walk in the kingdom, to act for the kingdom. And Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, we pray that your anointing will rest upon your children, Lord. Father, we thank you for this morning. We thank you because we know that you are at work. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching and other videos at gbcweb.tv. And before you go, an invitation especially for you. Why not visit us at Greenford Baptist Church on the corner of Beechwood Avenue and Ruislip Road in Greenford, West London, the United Kingdom. Our postcode is UB69UA. Our phone number is 020 8575 5034 and our TV website is gbcweb.tv. We look forward to seeing you soon.